Lord to reach you at the point of your need. I have not come with my own word. I have nothing to say. If I have anything to say, I've already said it as I shared this testimony. But I want God to speak to all of us. Myself, yourself, oh God, speak to us. Precious Lord, Almighty King of Glory, my Father, my God, I pray, Jehovah, as you have gathered us this morning, Lord, speak to us, minister to us, open our ears, open our hearts, that the entrance of your word will give life to us, and by reason of this life, O God, we'll step out there to bring glory to your name. Have your way, O God. All the enemies and opposers of this word of God, I come against them with the power in the name of Jesus. I dislodge them. And Father, I pray that you breathe upon the word and grant King of Glory that this word will carry everything your children need this morning. Lord, I pray, give us the strength, give us the power, give us the wisdom, give us the ability and the grace, O God, to do those things that will please you. Have your way and be glorified. Thank you, precious Father, because we have prayed and believed in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Once again, I want to also bring greetings to you from our Father. He's airborne now. This morning, he called me up to tell me that he was done with his ministrations in the UK. So he's on his way back to Nigeria right now. And he said, I told him I'm coming to worship with you. And he said I should bring his greetings to all of you. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Let me also use this opportunity to thank the angel of this covenant, the man of God that God has set up here to mobilize us and bring us together to worship God. I want to appreciate your spirit. I want to appreciate your humility. I want to appreciate the grace of God upon your life. We just met for the first time, a few days ago. But as we continue to discuss, it's as if we have known ourselves for 10 years before now. So I can just see a connection of the spirit. And I know that God have arranged it. I want to thank you, sir, for this great privilege you have given to me to minister on your altar.
Amen.
It's not by any other way, it's just that you yielded to God.
Amen.
And I believe that you will not lose your reward.
Amen.
Mama, the Lord bless you.
Amen.
Because I can see the man of God bubbling with joy. So if you are giving him trouble, his head will be down. The Lord bless you.
Amen.
It is well with you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Can we look together to the book in 1 Chronicles chapter 4. 1 Chronicles chapter 4. Within the few minutes I have, I want to see how much that God can speak to every one of us. We are reading a very popular portion of the scripture. I believe that as Bible students, you must have read, you must have heard, you might have also studied about this man we used this morning as a medium and as a case study. 1 Chronicles chapter 4, I'll read verse 9 and 10. As I look at the topic I call power to rise above limitations. The power to rise above limitations. In verse 9 of 1 Chronicles chapter 4, and Jabez was more honorable than his brethren. And his mother called his name Jabez, saying, because I bore him with sorrow. And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed, and enlarge my coasts, and that thy hand might be with me, and that thou wouldest keep me from evil, and that it may not grieve me. And God granted him that which he requested. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
This place just showed us a case of a man who found himself in a very bad situation, in an unpleasant situation. A man who saw himself in a frustrating situation, and he knew that he was not supposed to be there, and he knew he needed to do something. And many of us today, from time to time, we see ourselves in situations that are not palatable. We see ourselves in situations that are below our normal or the required standard. And we know the need to reach out to do something. But the unfortunate thing is that the average Christian goes to the wrong thing, goes to the wrong direction, does the wrong thing. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But this man, in spite of all other avenues available, he sought God. I want to talk about the power to rise above limitation. So you can see that if I want to take my time to teach on this as a teacher, I would have been looking at two key things. Number one, limitations. Then the other one will be power. Because these are two great forces. You jam one of it, whether you like it or not. When you meet with power, your situation changes. But if you are overtaken by limitations, you are in sorrow. But what is limitation? If I will need to open it up a little. What is limitation? Number one, I will look at limitation as something that is a limit. Something that brings a limit. Something that, you know, confines. Something that restricts. Something that, you know, dictates the extent of movement. For instance, we are within this auditorium. If the door is locked and with keys, you know that now we are limited to operate, to dance, to run, to walk, to do whatever we can do within this auditorium. So the walls become a restriction. They are now limitations. So we all operate within a limit. So whatever that restricts you or restrains you or confines you is limitation. And unfortunately, many times, Satan prescribes such limitations for God's people. And it ought not to be.
Amen.
Number two, a limitation can be a geographical boundary. Like those of us who are in Nigeria, you are limited within the nation. You can travel from one state to another, from one local government to another, but you are restricted from entering the plane and flying out to Europe or America, except you go through certain process. Then such limitation is broken. I hope you understand. So limitation could be geographical. Sometimes it's also spiritual. The third one I want to talk about, limitation, is also a prescribed maximum or a prescribed minimum. Some people, let's say some people who are in business, may be prescribed to operate within the maximum of $10 million. You do business, you go to whatever extent you can go. The moment your capital or your estate or your investment hits $10 million, you don't move beyond that, you begin to go down. It could also be a prescribed minimum. You begin to fall and collapse and go down, but you cannot go below $10,000. So the moment you get to that, something happens, you begin to move up again. So it's a prescribed minimum or prescribed maximum. That's a limitation. Some people don't grow, even in the civil service, even in, you know, their areas of vocation. They just discover that they are very intelligent. They discover that they are bright, very brilliant, and they know how to do things. But they just see themselves within a certain limit. Other people who came behind them will come and move ahead. And such person is frustrated. These are limitations. And the will of God and the desire of God and my prayer this morning is that any form of limitation that is around you will be broken.
Yeah.
In the name of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
A limitation is something that is intolerable. Something that is frustrating, exasperating. Something that chokes you. Something that makes you uncomfortable. Life becomes miserable. You know, like you move around, you discover that the system here in America has put certain things in place, that basic things that makes life good, makes life enjoyable, are already available. I don't know if you understand.
Yes.
If you go down to Africa, unfortunately, you discover that when you have 10%, 15 or 20% of what is available here, people are already looking at you as a jumbo high-class elite. I don't know if you understand.
Yes.
But yet, when you come over here, that is just the minimum, just the basics. But you know that even in the midst of this good environment, in the midst of everything put in place, some people are sweating inside the condition. Some people are frustrated. I don't know if you understand what I'm saying. I'm talking about limitations. The things that make you to regret life. The things that make you to wish you are not alive. You'll be surprised. And I want to tell you that people in Africa are wondering why a man living in London, living in the United States, can even attempt to commit suicide. Why? What can it be? But I want you to know that there are two forces that are still in charge. The positive and the negative. But God is in charge.
Amen.
I say that God is in charge.
Amen.
If you bring yourself under his government, you will enjoy all the residues. You enjoy the benefit and the dividends of his government. And I want to migrate every one of us today, spiritually, where we begin to enjoy freedom and liberty.
Woo!
Because the Lord says that you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. And in the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. And that's where we are going to. Jabez was a man, a child of God, a citizen of the kingdom, an Israelite, a Jew indeed. At least the fact that he prayed. And when you look at the content of his prayer, you will know that he was not praying as an alien. He was praying as a bona fide citizen of the kingdom. But before his prayers, in spite of God's promises, in spite of the covenant, in spite of everything that God has put in place for that nation, that man was in trouble. He was living a frustrating life. I want to look at some of the things that, you know, caused his problem to linger. Amen?
Amen.
He had a very bad history. Number one, his history was fighting him. Some of us are coming from places, if you look back into your history, you wouldn't want it to be opened up at all. If you look back to where you are coming from, you wouldn't like to mention to anybody. You wouldn't want any person to ask you, what is the name of your village? What's the name of your father? What was your condition when you were at so age and at so time? That was what was fighting Jabez. And Jabez was frustrated. You know that his mother gave him a name. You know, where I come from, in Igbo land, Nigeria, names portray what the parents experience. It portrays either their experience or their vision. If I want to tell you how that my name is given to me, Chidiebere, and I prefer it called that order, Chidiebere. And what it means is that God is merciful. There was something that happened. In fact, by the way, that was not the first name that was given to me. When I was born, a woman came in, a member of the family, and gave me a name. And little did anyone know that what she had in mind was what she gave in that name. Are we together?
Yes.
And little after then, she began to operate. And I was meant to be in eternity now. At the age of 3 months, just 3 months, you know how fragile that life was. And then, at such an age, this woman fed me with raw acid.
Jesus.
To the point that every organ, everything that is inside of me was gone. My mother just stepped out. She came in and did that. So blood was gushing out from the ear, from the nose, from every opening of my body. I was found on the pool of blood. I was taken to the best of the hospitals that could be at that time. That is the University College Hospital in Ibadan. The doctors tried and did everything. There was nothing they could do. And yet, that life did not go. They abandoned me with my parents. You know, was taken back home. It was just my grandfather. My maternal grandfather was a believer. So he mobilized people to pray. And as they kept praying and praying, and it was said that one day, there is always a one day. The one day will come soon. In the name of Jesus Christ. One day that I vomited those black substance. Fill a bucket that wouldn't, where did it come from? Inside of this small thing. And after then, that I now smiled. They gave me water, I drank. And by that time, my mother's breast milk had dried off. And that was how life now started all over. And they now brought that name, Chidiebere. God is merciful. So, the one standing before you, just standing by the mercy of God. For me, the life had gone. The enemy struck. But can I tell you very quickly that your destiny is not in the hand of your enemy. Let me tell you, child of God, when God was going to bring you to this earth, he did not consult Satan. He did not consult your enemy. So God brought you at his own volition. So whatever happens to you is between you and God. So God is not waiting for the advice or counsel, the opinion of your enemy to determine what happens to you. Are we together? Jabez found himself in a jackpot, destroyed history. His mother gave him the name Jabez and said, because I bore him in sorrow. The Bible didn't go further to tell us what actually happened. Could it be that the day he was given birth to, his father died? Could it be that the day he was born, his father lost his job? Could it be that the day he was being delivered, the whole of their house caught fire? Something happened that brought sorrow. And that name was given to him, sorrow. And he continued with it. I could imagine when he now got to a time, he went to primary school, and the head teacher would ask him, what is your name? Want to register you? He said, my name is Sorrow. And they would write Sorrow. And when they are playing in the playground, he's like, Sorrow, where are you? Here am I. Sorrow. And this thing continued with him. That was his history. And let me tell you, the pronouncement that is made on you carries some power. That is why even God himself, he come around to change people's name. When Jacob was struggling, a man of great destiny, the one that was going to now give birth to the nation, was struggling with all his intelligence, with all his prayer, with everything. He was struggling by reason of that name, Jacob, that was given to him. A time came when he encountered God. God said, before you get into your destiny, something is going to happen. And his name was changed from a man to a nation. Are we together?
Amen.
So Jabez was carrying the name, and that thing was haunting him, and it was fighting him. And he kept on with it. Until he came